The Nintendo Switch has been nothing short of a phenomenon, with over 150 million units sold and more than a billion games shipped since its launch. But even the most successful console eventually needs a worthy successor, and no one understands that better than Nintendo. This is how Nintendo made the Switch 2. The Switch 2's development was led by a trio of seasoned Nintendo veterans. Goichi Kawamoto, who joined Nintendo in 1997 and previously served as a general director of the original Nintendo Switch, took on the role of producer for the Switch 2. In this position, he helped define the overall vision for the new system and worked closely with the hardware development team and other departments to refine its specifications. Takahiro Dota, who started at Nintendo in 2003 as a programmer and later became the technical director for the Legend of Zelda series, served as a director of the Switch 2. He brought a valuable software developer's perspective to the project, helping to shape the system's design with an emphasis on user experience and functionality. Tetsuya Sasaki, a 30-year Nintendo veteran from the technology development division, acted as a technical director. He oversaw the development of the Switch 2's hardware, its core system software, and the network infrastructure that supports online services. Development on the Switch 2 quietly began as early as 2019, even before the official project kickoff. Nintendo had already been researching new technologies. Hardware development takes years, and Nintendo wanted its software teams to hit the ground running with a stable, powerful platform. Instead of designing the entire console all at once, the company prioritized components that required the most time and testing. This approach ensured that software development kits would be ready early, allowing software developers to start building games as soon as possible. The team focused much of their effort on implementing a significantly more powerful processor to boost the system's overall performance. While they felt that the original Switch's processor, NVIDIA's Tegra X1, was the best choice at the time, its limitations quickly became apparent. Developers soon found themselves constrained by its processing capabilities, unable to fully realize their creative visions. For the Switch 2, Nintendo once again partnered with NVIDIA, this time opting for a custom processor built specifically for the new system. The chip features a GPU designed exclusively for the Switch 2, complete with dedicated RT cores and Tensor cores. The RT cores enable more realistic visuals through dynamic lighting and natural reflections, while the Tensor cores power advanced AI-driven graphics while maintaining energy efficiency. The result is a graphics performance that's up to 10 times greater than that of the original Switch. Thanks to these hardware upgrades, the developers of Donkey Kong Bonanza were able to implement fully destructible environments, while Mario Kart World lets players seamlessly drive between interconnected courses. Since the days of the Nintendo DS, the company has prioritized introducing new ways to play by incorporating hardware features that were unconventional for game consoles at the time, encouraging developers to take full advantage of them. However, Nintendo admits that with the original Switch, this approach took a backseat. Instead, the focus shifted to creating a flexible platform that allowed developers to make any kind of game without feeling pressure to utilize unique hardware features. During early development of the Switch 2, Nintendo wasn't sure whether to iterate on the original Switch's design or make something completely new. Therefore, the team explored a variety of unique hardware concepts. In the end, they chose to prioritize the flexibility that both developers and players have come to expect, rather than introducing features that might feel like gimmicks. If Nintendo wants to offer new gameplay experiences in the future, they can still do so through accessories, just as they did with Ring Fit Adventure and Nintendo Labo. That said, the team gave serious thought to redesigning the system itself, wondering if there might be a better way to approach the hybrid console concept. Ultimately, they decided it was best to preserve the core design of the Switch rather than make quote-unquote changes for change's sake. The new screen is noticeably larger and supports 1080p resolution, refresh rates up to 120 frames per second, and more vivid colors thanks to HDR. Like the original Switch, it also features touch controls. Interestingly, during development of the first Switch, Nintendo's engineers considered removing the touchscreen functionality, since it couldn't be used in TV mode. However, the late Satoru Iwata, who was Nintendo's president at the time, advised against it and said, "I'm sure there will be games that make use of it, so why not keep it?" Before we move on, I'd like to talk about this video's sponsor, Boot.dev. Boot.dev is an online platform that has turned learning how to code into a fun and captivating RPG experience. They provide courses for the programming language Python and Go, so you can learn backend web development from start to finish. The platform is designed to make sure you'll be writing a ton of code, as the people at Boot.dev believe the best way to learn to program is by getting your hands on the keyboard and completing projects. All the while, you'll be earning XP, levels, and achievements by completing quests. Not everyone has the means to pay for a membership, membership, so all of their content is free to read and watch in guest mode. A paid membership unlocks the game and all the interactive components that go with it, the whole reason why boot.dev is so engaging and efficient at teaching you how to code. Furthermore, the boot.dev Discord community is very active and there to help if you ever get stuck on your coding challenges. Click the link in the description box and use my code ThatGuyGlen to get 25% off your first payment for boot.dev. That's 25% off your first month or your first year, depending on the subscription you choose. Boot.dev, learn backend web development the smart way. Now back to the video. Nintendo carefully balanced processing power and memory to create a system designed to stay relevant over time. To achieve this long-term performance, the team had to impose certain restrictions. For example, with Switch 2 games featuring larger file sizes, fast data access became essential to ensure smooth gameplay. In Mario Kart World, where players can freely explore a vast open environment, the system must quickly load distant areas in real time. To support this, the Switch 2 uses high-speed microSD Express cards instead of the older microSD format, allowing large amounts of data to be read and rendered in advance. At the same time, efforts were made to avoid a significant drop in battery life. One such measure was increasing the battery capacity to 1.2 times that of the original Switch. The Joy-Con 2 controllers have been completely redesigned from the ground up. They're larger to match the new console and feature bigger, more durable control sticks with smoother movement. During prototype testing, developers found that simply scaling up the original Joy-Con made them awkward to hold. Fingers couldn't easily reach the L and R buttons, and the controllers didn't sit well in users' palms. To address this, the team lengthened the L and R buttons, rounded the bottom corners, and carefully adjusted the placement of sticks and buttons, down to the millimeter, for better ergonomics. Recognizing that comfort varies by hand size, they also invited developers with smaller hands to test the prototypes and provide feedback. HD Rumble in the Switch 2 has been upgraded to deliver a wider range of tactile feedback. While the original Joy-Con offered varied vibration effects, its compact size limited the strength of those sensations, especially when compared to more robust controllers like those from the GameCube era. The new version delivers stronger, more realistic feedback with quicker response times. During early development of the original Switch, Nintendo considered using magnets to attach the Joy-Con controllers for quick and easy sharing. However, when Satoru Iwata saw the prototypes, he pointed out that the controllers wobbled when connected to the console due to the weak magnetic hold. Based on his feedback, the idea was scrapped in favor of the more stable rail system. Still, the development team wasn't ready to abandon the concept entirely. Tetsuya Sasaki's team continued researching magnetic attachment systems. During the development of the Switch 2 and after extensive trial and error, Nintendo's engineers perfected the magnetic technology. The result is a new design that securely clicks the Joy-Con 2 controllers into place, while allowing them to detach smoothly with a light press of the release button. The idea to use a Joy-Con controller as a mouse wasn't part of the original plan. It came to Kawamoto while he was playing PC games. Given that the Switch 2 was designed to support a wider range of games thanks to its enhanced processing power, Kawamoto thought it made sense to include mouse functionality for titles that could benefit from it. The feature was inexpensive to implement and reflects the philosophy of the late, legendary Nintendo visionary Gunpei Yoko: lateral thinking with withered technology. The idea of repurposing mature, readily available technology in creative new ways. It's a principle that has long influenced Nintendo's approach to innovation. When Kawamoto proposed the idea to the technology development team, their response was, "Oh, we've been thinking about that for ages." Of course, using a mouse while sitting on a couch presents a challenge, as tables are often out of reach. To address this, the team fine-tuned the functionality so the Joy-Con could track movement on a variety of surfaces, including something as casual as a pair of pants. In fact, some developers even found they preferred using it that way. While the new Pro controller may look similar at first glance, it was redesigned from the ground up. The control sticks were engineered to be quieter, even when moved quickly to the edge, and to glide more smoothly. During development, they were nicknamed smooth gliding sticks. Special attention was also given to reducing the slight bumping sensation that can occur when tilting the sticks. This redesign is part of Nintendo's long-standing pursuit to create the quote-unquote pinnacle of all controllers. The grip handles were inspired in part by the Nintendo GameCube controller. The base of each grip was made thinner to give fingers more room, and the seam around the grip area was removed to improve comfort during extended play sessions. New buttons labeled GL and GR were also added on the back of the grip handles. Players can assign any button inputs they want to these two buttons. While the original Switch supports voice chat through the Nintendo Switch Online smartphone app, it was originally intended to be a built-in feature. However, due to hardware limitations at the time, in-system voice chat wasn't possible without negatively impacting gameplay performance. With the Switch 2's improved processing power, developers were finally able to integrate voice chat directly into the console as a standard feature. Nintendo's goal was to recapture the feeling of gathering with friends, whether playing the same game or different ones. Just like kids hanging out at a friend's house or young adults relaxing in a student lounge. One of the console's new features, screen sharing, was inspired by the development team's experience working remotely during the COVID-19 pandemic. Back then, they relied on video conferencing tools to review in-progress software, but those platforms only allowed one gameplay screen to be shared at a time. To work around this, team members began pointing their webcams at their own screens instead of their faces. This improvised solution unexpectedly recreated the feeling of being in the same room, each person playing on their own console, and it sparked the idea for a native screen sharing feature on the Switch 2 called Game Chat. When developing Game Chat, the team had to carefully consider which features to include, since dedicating too much processing power to voice chat and screen sharing could compromise gameplay performance. Fortunately, they had a group of meticulous and outspoken software developers who weren't shy about voicing their opinions. This open dialogue helped the team strike a thoughtful balance. It also reflects Nintendo's workplace culture, where developers feel empowered to speak up and collaborate freely, allowing them to focus on creating products that are distinctly and authentically Nintendo. Getting Game Chat to work on Switch 2 is a prime example of this collaborative process. The software and system developers started discussing how much processing power should be spent on the software versus the system, almost like a budget negotiation. "You're right," the software developers would say. "We want all these features, but with a system resource budget of zero." And the system developers would come back with, "I'm afraid we can't work within that budget." But as we tried out prototypes and communicated with each other, we started to get a feel for how much processing capability and memory was needed for a particular level of functionality, and where we should allocate more budget. Through such repeated efforts, we were able to reach a common understanding of which features were worth including based on how much of the system's processing power they would use. The Nintendo Switch 2 features a high-performance audio processing chip designed to eliminate unwanted background noise. Software developers made specific and thoughtful requests for the noise-canceling system. They wanted disruptive sounds like vacuum cleaners to be filtered out, but didn't want expressions of excitement, such as cheering or applause, to be suppressed. Striking that balance was technically demanding. Deciding which sounds to block and which to allow required extensive development and fine-tuning. While speech clarity was a key priority, the team also focused on preserving the energy and emotion of a shared gaming experience. In the end, the developers pushed for what initially seemed impossible, but their persistence resulted in a voice chat system that's both immersive and expressive. As with the original Switch, the Joy-Con 2 controllers can be shared between players. However, even during the development of the first Switch, the team had aspirations that went beyond just sharing controllers. They wanted players to be able to share the games themselves between systems. This idea was inspired by earlier features like download play on the Game Boy Advance and Nintendo DS, which allowed players to send portions of a game to friends for local multiplayer. While the team explored bringing a similar feature to the Switch, the large data sizes of modern games made transfers too slow to be practical, and the concept had to be set aside. With the Switch 2, the team revisited the concept, this time leveraging the system's increased processing power, and by incorporating streaming technology similar to what the Wii U used to transmit images from the console to the gamepad. This approach enabled near-instant sharing of gameplay between devices without requiring full game data transfers. The vision was for players to be able to jump into games together, whether cooperatively or competitively, with minimal setup. The request was passed to Tetsuya Sasaki and the technology development department, where the team had already been researching wireless streaming technologies in anticipation of just such a need. Their goal was to be ready with a solution the moment it was called for. From the outset, the team wanted the Switch 2 to be compatible with original Switch games, though they were warned early on that this would pose significant technical challenges. At one point, it wasn't even clear if it would be possible. In the early stages of development, the primary focus was on boosting hardware performance and expanding system capabilities. Backward compatibility was considered a lower priority. Unlike previous systems, such as a Nintendo 3DS, which included DS hardware, or the Wii U, which contained Wii components, the Switch 2 was built with a different design philosophy and does not include built-in Switch hardware. This made achieving compatibility with older titles far more complex. Rather than relying on traditional hardware inclusion or full software emulation, the team eventually managed to develop a hybrid approach, something between the two. A pure software emulator would have required the system to run at full capacity, significantly impacting battery life. Instead, they created a system that performs real-time data conversion as games are read, allowing original Switch titles to run smoothly on the new hardware. Although the technological groundwork had been laid, the team was initially unsure whether full compatibility could be achieved. Still, they believed that features like game chat, if available for both Switch 2 and original Switch games, could enhance gameplay and offer fresh experiences. With that vision in mind, they pushed to see whether it was possible to run the entire Switch library on the new system. After all, if it couldn't, it wouldn't feel like a true successor. Their goal became clear: to be able to say, Switch games will run on Switch 2. At first, the development team lacked confidence in how well compatibility would hold up, but as they began testing games individually, they found that many issues could be resolved through targeted adjustments. This process built confidence that, while not every issue could be fixed, a large number of games could indeed be made to work. To ensure broad compatibility, the team, led by Sasaki and others, undertook the massive task of checking each title from the expansive Switch library, which now includes over 12,000 games, one by one. While not every game is guaranteed to run perfectly at the launch of Switch 2, the team remains committed to ongoing efforts to support as many titles as possible. The team explored a wide range of ideas for the name, and it was a struggle to find the right one. Fan favorite ideas like Super Nintendo Switch were on the list, but didn't feel quite right. We even considered ideas like Super Nintendo Switch. However, Super NES, which came out after the NES, couldn't play NES games. Since Switch 2 can play Switch games, it didn't feel right to use the same naming convention as Super NES. Switch 2 is a new system with improved performance, but we'd like players who get their hands on it not to focus on the specs, but rather to think of it as the latest system developed by Nintendo. From the very beginning, the goal was to create a console that could be enjoyed by a broad audience, not just those drawn to high-end hardware. The name Nintendo Switch 2 was ultimately chosen because it communicates clearly and simply to consumers that this is the next evolution in the Switch family. Nintendo first unveiled the Switch 2 in January 2025, followed by a deeper look during a dedicated Nintendo Direct 3 months later. At first glance, the Nintendo Switch 2 may look like a familiar successor, but underneath its polished design lies years of collaboration, innovation, and quiet reinvention. From reimagining the controllers and boosting system performance to introducing screen sharing and built-in voice chat, the team focused on features that empower both developers and players, without compromising the core appeal of the original Switch. With backward compatibility, a more refined user experience, and a name that emphasizes continuity over spectacle, the Switch 2 represents a confident step into the future. It honors Nintendo's legacy while embracing what comes next.